throughout the first day, he managed his times to keep Yere within 30 seconds after the opening loop. Alistair Fischer was also showing his pace in Germany, battling with Breen for second place, and it was all looking good until a puncture on the final stage of the day cost him nearly 3 minutes, and he dropped from third to 11th and out of the running.
You're going to have to stop, 15k to go. Get her down here, you're going to have to stop, yeah. Make sure she's flat, yeah.
That promoted another Pirelli star driver into the top three in the form of Andrea Crinola. Openly admitting that tarmac is his favoured surface, Andrea was showing his form but wasn't able to match the pace of the top two ahead of him. Lemesh was the man who ended the day on top after a faultless drive, but he could not afford to ease off. Breen was pushing him hard. As the first leg came to a close, the Irishman was his usual animated self, not happy with his performance over the final stage and some work to do on day two.
I thought it would have dropped about 20 seconds or so because I was driving like my grandmother all the way down the hills and something's bent a little bit, so lucky. Luck is on our side for a change.
Your grandmother must be quick then.
She doesn't go, but she drives hard, in fairness, my grandmother.
As in Finland, the WRC Academy was set for a final day showdown, and once again, Craig Breen was the man to watch, chasing down the 36-second deficit to Lemesh. So as has been the Academy programme all year, just 2 days of rallying makes up each event, and on the second and final day, it was Lemesh who led the young WRC hopefuls into the stages in his bid to claim his first victory this year. And it all began well, taking the second fastest time through the first stage of the day, just 1.8 seconds slower than Jan Czerny. But on the following stage, his campaign for the win would come to an abrupt end. Outbraking himself into a junction cost him nearly a minute, dropping down to second, 16.2 behind Breen. With just six stages left to run, Breen found himself in the hot seat and just had to keep it on the black stuff throughout the remainder of the day to ensure almost certain victory. Despite this, the Irishman was not backing off, but could he hold his nerve? Well, one man who couldn't was Egon Kaur. Having dropped to fifth during the day, he was still on course for 10 points, a good result on a surface he's not familiar with. However, on the final stage, an uncharacteristic mistake from the championship leader saw him go off the road, puncturing a tyre and damaging the oil sump. The error cost him over 2 minutes, three places, and Egon had to settle for eighth overall. Jose Suarez was now up to fourth place and en route for his best finish of the year. Unable to challenge Crinola for the final podium spot, Jose decided to play it safe and ease off to bring it home for 12 championship points behind Crinola and Lemesh in second. But the main celebrations were in car number 109. Having led every single event this year, only to be stopped due to retirement or driver error, Craig Breen prevailed, bringing his Fiesta home to take his maiden victory in the WRC Academy. Handshakes all round as the delighted Breen celebrated his first win.
Great job.
Thank you.
I think the feeling that we had in Finland finishing second was enough to push us that little bit extra on the second round of Panzerplatte, and it got us the win, and you know, 30 points in total, including our stage wins, which is fantastic. Egon, unfortunately for him, fortunately for me, had a fairly bad weekend, so it puts us in contention again, which definitely this weekend it wasn't looking so good, but now we're back on track.
Well, another close finish in the WRC Academy. Celebrations for Breen and commiserations for Lemesh, eventually settling for second, 15.1 behind. Andrea Crinola rounds out the top three with Suarez and Jan Czerny closing out the Academy top five. So as Breen finally gets his chance to spray the winner's champagne, celebrating his first victory of the year, let's take a look at how it affects the championship. And the first poor performance from Kaur meant he only picked up 4 points, while Breen, taking into account his five stage wins, took 30. The championship has suddenly come alive. Kaur's advantage cut from 52 points to 26. With the next round in France also on tarmac, could this be a turning point in the WRC Academy? In this edition of Rally World's New Faces, we caught up with WRC hopeful and Australian Academy driver Brendan Reeves. Despite a difficult weekend in Germany, Brendan has proved his pace this year, taking 3 fourth places in the first three events. He sat down with us to tell us about his career so far and his plans for the future.
What made you want to become a rally driver? Was there any sort of family history in motor racing?
My dad was a rally driver, so I was always out there watching him and helping service the car. And when I grew up on a farm in country Victorian Australia, so I was driving a paddock bomb around the paddocks and riding motorbikes from when I could walk, basically, and once I turned 17 started rally driving. So it's been an onward progression from there, and it's amazing now to be at WRC level.
Brendan has shown blistering pace in this inaugural year of the WRC Academy, but what are his thoughts on this all-new stepping stone to the World Rally Championship?
The experience of the Academy has been amazing so far this year. It's a real challenge for everyone. We haven't done many WRC events before at all, so it's a fresh start coming to all these European rallies. Competition's still great, so it's been an awesome opportunity so far.
The competition in the Academy has been fantastic all year, but who has impressed Brendan the most?
Egon, obviously, getting 3 wins out of the 3 first rounds is impressive, but Craig Breen's always been fast. He just hasn't been able to capitalise and finish it off. So there's some really top drivers, but that's great for me because it pushes me harder as well and will make me into a better driver.
And what about his personal highlight of the championship so far?
Finland was a real highlight. It's just a rally that I've really always looked up to, and as a kid growing up, that's the rally you really want to do, and now it's hard to believe that I've been there and done the rally and come fourth. It was a great experience.
After a really promising start to the year, Germany presented Brendan with his toughest test yet, finishing a disappointing 13th. He talked us through his weekend.
It started off tough. Stage one, halfway through, we locked up the front brakes and went off the road. Luckily we didn't damage the car, so we got back on and we dropped 6 minutes. So from there on, it was basically, we're at the back of the field, had to try and get through every stage and try and claw back some positions, but it just didn't happen throughout the whole rally.
And alongside him in the car, it's not just his co-driver, it's his sister Rhiannon, affectionately known as Toby. But is there any sibling rivalry inside the car?
The car for us, it works really well. We enjoy rallying together as well because we know each other so well. So it's been working great so far, and hopefully we have many years of success to come.
She isn't too much of a backseat driver or a nagging passenger?
Not at all. I always are asking her 10 million questions in the car. Okay, how far to the next stage? How much time we got? And I keep her busy, but she does a great job.
So what of the future for the brother and sister partnership?
I really want to be a WRC driver in an outright car, so we'll just keep working hard this year and try and get the best result we can to make next year work as well and be back in the championship.
Plenty more still to come in Rally World. After the break, we go behind the scenes to a pre-rally test with the Ford Abu Dhabi team. We bring you all the latest news from around the sport, including an insight into Kenblock's spectacular new Gymkhana video.
It's fun just being creative on these sides of finding these situations and being able to figure out different things to do with the car.
And we bring you the inside line into the all-new Rally Australia on the stunning Coffs Coast. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back to Rally World. We're back on gravel for round 10 in Australia. As ever, the teams have been working hard behind the scenes to prepare for the latest WRC challenge. One of the most important aspects of rallying is the time spent testing. Without this crucial testing, a team's chance of success is very slim. It's the time when drivers and their engineers can really focus on the minor details of the setup and make sure the driver is completely happy and confident in their car before entering an event. We joined the Ford Abu Dhabi World Rally team for a behind-the-scenes look at a recent gravel test in Finland.
We need to go back.
George is our test manager. So I think during my carry, he has only missed one test. He's always there running the tests. We have a Mick Maunder doing the food. Andy. He's in a charge of morale with what is all this happening with the car. Also, we have many other people, like same guys who have done testing. They are also in, it's like a test team. So most of the guys are the same. Of course, there will be some changes. And then our rally engineers, Tim and Tom, they are most of the time always in test.
Generally on a test we'll have two chassis engineers, one looking at the data and one working with the driver.
There's a massive amount of parameters, and I mean, in the WRC the events vary so much, from the snow in Sweden, the tarmac of Spain, etc., and to the fast gravel rallies in Finland.
Whilst Tim is working hard from the comfort of his computer, Tom is out manually adjusting the car from the data already gathered.
Depending what we're trying to achieve, we tend to do fairly big steps at times just to get an idea of what direction it's going. That's it. And then as the test goes on, it turns to more fine-tuning. So a bit of both, really.
It's really fantastic.
We have to just reset the rebound every time we fit the damper. It's the controls the damping when the damper's falling towards the ground.
The damper works in two directions. There's the compression, which is when the car is going down, and then the rebound when the car moves up or the ground moves away from the car. So when the wheels are falling, that's the rebound side. Wheels are going up towards the car, that's the compression side.
Of course, we are really trying to work hard to make the car faster and make it better to drive as well. And so if they have new parts, we test those, how they work. And all the time we just try different things, because there's millions of things you can do with the car. So even though we have a good setup, we can just, you know, try different kind of compromises with different kind of roll bars and springs and dampers, and trying to find something better from it. So it's kind of a work that really never ends.
There is only so much an engineer can tweak in the setup. The rest and the most important information comes from how the driver feels, as Jari Matti explains.
Three elements: hands, legs, and the bottom. That's where basically the bottom is the one, the most sensitive area, because that's how you feel how the car is on the balance. But of course you feel with the legs, if the brakes are not working right, if the pedal is soft, hard, or the disc is bent, things like that. You feel it with the legs, how the grip is on the braking. With the hands, you feel the jumps, you feel the impacts. You feel basically quite a lot the front tires. I mean, if you have a flat front tire, you feel it for the hands. But if you have a flat rear tire, you feel it for your bottom. I'm pleased. We have done two very long days, a lot of driving. We have done a lot of small changes. At the end of the day, I think I have a good feeling for the car and for the road.
For sure, in Australia, surface is a little bit different, but generally it's a bit faster rally as well. So setup we find here, we can definitely use as a base for Australia and for GP or any faster gravel rally there is.
In the news this week, following the fallout between Sebastien Ogier and his team in Germany, rumours had circulated that the Frenchman could leave at the end of the season, with Ford a possible destination. For now, though, it appears Ogier will remain with Citroën for at least another year. With Volkswagen announcing they have narrowed their list of potential drivers from 25 to 6, the second outing for their test team saw the WRC Academy's Christian Reidemann finish as the highest-placed local driver in 15th overall. Meanwhile, 2010 JWRC runner-up Hans Weiss Jr. was the second-best S2000 car behind SWRC winner Oit Tanak.